Today we're going to talk about the power of position, how to unlock your miracle, and don't confuse miracle with instantaneous. So today's message is titled, Unlock Your Miracle. When I was a little kid, I mean really little, my grandpa passed when I was 9 years old. I lived in Omaha. He lived in Osceola, Iowa. He called it Osceola. And he was probably my favorite person in the world. End up. Yeah. Wow, all those years. Grandpa, that's what I'm calling him. If he told me he was going to do something, I never questioned it. I just knew he was going to do it. Grandpa always had a couple things in his pocket. He always had a can of key tobacco. Mike, you knew him, didn't you? They called him Doc. And he had lifesavers. Because I couldn't have the tobacco, he would give me lifesavers. And every time I would see Grandpa, he would give me a lifesaver. He'd give me a quarter if I could sit still for 2 or 3 minutes at a time. I didn't make a lot of quarters, but he just always paid attention. And if he said he was going to do something, he did it. There was no question. And it was kind of with him, I knew that I could ask him and he would say yes, where I may ask my mother or my father and they might say maybe, or they might say no. I never got a no from Grandpa. And I remember I was with him. He used to take me fishing, and he loved to fish for bluegill, and he called them crappie. They were crappie. I had a fishing pole, and he had a fishing pole whenever my fishing pole wasn't in the water, and he was pulling me out of the water. But Grandpa always had a cane pole. If you're just really young, you don't know what a cane pole is. A cane pole is a stick pole. And his came in three pieces, so it was kind of long, and it was so cool. Because, I mean, we had these fancy reels and rods, but he would catch so many bluegill on that cane pole. He would catch so many big bluegill on that cane pole. Because he'd just throw it out there with a worm and a bobber, and I'm working, you know, trying to catch a fish with a lure, and he'd be pulling in bluegill after bluegill. And I said, Grandpa, would you get me a cane pole? I want a cane pole. He said, for your birthday. Now, that was September, maybe August, September, and my birthday wasn't until the following July. But you know what? I got happy. I got excited. Because I was going to get my own, you know, fish-finding cane pole. I was going to get my own magic cane pole. And even though it was 10 months away, I was just a little kid. I didn't understand what 10 months away meant. He said, I'm going to get it for your birthday. So, you know, I'm excited about my birthday. And every time I think about him, I think about my cane pole. Remember, he lived in Osceola and I lived in Omaha. And we only saw each other 2 or 3 times a year. So that next July, I came, and I got to spend 5 days with my grandpa, and we went fishing. And I remember the first day, I expected that I was going to get this cane pole. I was so excited. I figured Grandpa had put it in the trunk. And we got there because it wasn't my birthday. It was before. I expected it to be there. Guess what? I didn't get a fish with a cane pole because I didn't have a cane pole. We went fishing 2 more times before my birthday, and I didn't have a cane pole. But on my birthday, I mean, I woke up knowing we're going to go fishing, and I'm going to fish with my cane pole. And that's exactly what happened. He pulled that thing out of the back of his trunk, and we pieced it together, and we strung it up, and we went fishing, and we caught a lot of fish. And it was exciting. But I want you to understand something. My joy came when he made the promise. And I had joy to carry me through 10 weeks or 10 months because I knew that if Grandpa said it, he was going to do it. It was just there was something in the middle called time, right? I didn't understand it then, but I did understand my grandpa. I understood he was generous. I understand he was a man of his word. I understand that if he said he was going to do it, he was going to do it. And the Bible says that we're to accept God's ways as a little child. Did you see a picture of me as a little child yet? You got one of those? This is the face that Grandpa, I'm the one in the middle. And Grandpa could not say no to. That's my brother and my sister. We're too, like that little Kenny up there. We're too, look at those bright eyes, man. I hadn't been through some stuff yet. But that's the way we're to look at the kingdom of God. We're to look at it with excitement, with enthusiasm, with expectation. I mean, you know, when I woke up and I knew, I mean, a week before, I remember sitting on my swing because it was summer, and I was swinging back and forth, and I was making up some silly song about going to Osceola and fishing with the cane pole. You get a line, I get a pole, honey, you know, something like that. And I was singing it just so excited. That face should be the face of our spirit, should be the face of our soul, should be the face that's on top of our shoulders when we're going through some rough stuff. Jesus said we're to be like a little child. There was a time when all the disciples were with him, and you know, he was gaining in popularity, and the kids were just everywhere, and they didn't know that they weren't supposed to come up to Jesus. They didn't know that there was some kind of protocol. They didn't know that Jesus was so important that he should only talk to adults, and so they just kind of swallowed him. And the disciples started rebuking them and sending them away. And Jesus got, well, the word says he became he got pissed off. And he said, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said that. Need you, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said. He got mad. And he said, let the little children come to me. And he said, don't hinder them. For the kingdom of God doesn't belong to you adults alone. He said, the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Remember that picture? My grandpa used to say, bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. You're just expecting something. The kingdom of God belongs to those who are like these children. Verse 15, he goes on, he says, truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will not enter it. Now, I'm going to give you a little awakening here. When Jesus said, truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God will not, like a little child, will not enter it, he wasn't talking about heaven. Because Jesus said the kingdom of God is here when he's walking on the earth, and soon it will be in you. If you want to experience God's ways, if you want to experience the miraculous power of God, if you want to experience the empowerment of God, if you want to experience the wisdom and the love of God, you've got to receive it like that little child. I can't even do it. Bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. You're expecting God to come through. You're expecting God to do what he promised you. It's not a matter of will he or won't he. There is an expectation on the inside of you that grows. And Jesus took these little children and he placed his hands on them and he blessed them. All these people were trying to get to Jesus to touch him to get blessed. But Jesus went after the ones that were bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, the ones that had excitement, the ones that had enthusiasm, the ones that had something building on the inside of them. They just knew that he was good. And you know what they got in return? They didn't get rebuked. They didn't get turned away. They got Jesus, the hands that created the universe, laid on them and blessed them, which means empowered them to prosper, empowered them to go forth, empowered them to increase, empowered them to do more. And the kingdom of God comes to us not when we go to heaven, but when we believe. Can I get an amen in the house? And when we believe with expectation, that gives us strength to stand the test and the trials of time. Because, sweet pea, Jesus never said it's going to be easy. As a matter of fact, he said, you better strap down, baby, because this thing's going to get tough. People are going to persecute you. People are going to lie about you. Things are going to happen. You'll be attacked. But he said, hey, I'm with you. I'm with you. And he's given us some promises to hang on to in the middle of trials and tribulations. Go to James chapter 1, verse 2. This is going to be our key scripture for today. This is probably one of the most pointed scriptures in the Bible. It is probably one of the most direct scriptures in the Bible, but it is probably one of the least applied scriptures in the Word of God. Are you hearing me? In other words, this is really clear what it's saying, but we don't apply it to our lives because we think it's subjective, as if what happens around us is going to cause our emotional level to reach a point that we think is joy, which is not joy at all. Happiness is based on happiness, but joy is based on the justification that Jesus has purchased for us. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters. When you get saved, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters. When you get the cane pole, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters. When you get out of debt, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters. When God reconciles your family, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters. When that prodigal comes home, is that what it says? No, he says, consider it pure joy when you face trials of many, somebody say many, kinds. How can I consider something that hurts joyful? How can I consider something that causes pain and is hard to endure joyful? Well, that's not really what he's saying. That word consider in the Greek is the word hegalmai, and it means to be in the lead. It means to lead. So he's talking about considering is the way that the translators put this. You let your main thought, you let the thought that leads be the one that produces joy. You have to frame your world that what you look at is going to be based on how you see things. And how you see things is going to be based on the lenses that you view things through. And if I'm looking for doom and gloom, if that is my lens, guess what I'm going to see no matter where I go? Doom and gloom. If I have lenses that are full of suffering and pain, guess what I'm going to see? Guess what I'm going to feel everywhere I go? Doom and gloom and pain. Now, I'm not talking about mind over matter. I'm talking a scriptural principle here. When we let God's faithfulness lead in our thoughts, if I have a loss and a doom and a gloom mentality, I would say, well, Grandpa said he was going to get me that pole, but it's probably going to bust when I get it. Grandpa said he's going to give me that pole, but, you know, he might and he might not. Grandpa said he was going to give me that pole, but I don't deserve it. I have to be really good for it. When I get to this point that I'm really, really good, then he's going to get it to me. That wasn't my grandpa. But if I consider God's faithfulness, man, he does what he says and he says what he does. The Bible says that he doesn't speak and then not perform. He doesn't promise and not fulfill. The Word of God says he's not a man that he should lie or he would change his mind, and that his gifts and his callings are without repentance. In other words, if he promises to you, he's not going to say, next week, I changed my mind. And when you get to know God, I mean not know about him, but you begin to experience God in a personal way, guess what begins to happen? You begin to realize he is faithful. He does come through. Now, he may be slow on my calendar, but he always comes through. But that slowness on the calendar might not have to do so much with time as it does with your perception. Because from August and September, all the way to July, I mean, that was like a hop, skip, and a jump. There were a lot of things to do in between, a lot of things to be preoccupied as a seven-year-old. There was a lot of swings to swing, a lot of dirt to play with, a lot of trees to climb. And then I knew it was coming, so I had 6 to 9 months of joy. But if I didn't believe he was going to give it to me, if I had to ask him every time I talked to him, are you still going to get me that? Hey, I just want you to remember now, I've been really good. Then that time is going to drag and it's going to become kind of miserable. You see, our thought process is a lot like our visual process. The way we think is a lot like the way that we see. We see through the lenses that are over our corneas, and those can change. And when they're kind of off, guess what the doctor does? He puts you behind this machine, and he begins to change the things that you see. So he says, look at those letters and tell me, is this clear or is that not? And then he sets the first lens, the primary lens. Everybody say primary. He sets the primary lens. He gets that set for both eyes. And then he begins to tweak it with other lenses after that so you could get clear, crystal clear vision from far away and crystal clear vision for up close. The lenses that we view are God through are the lenses that we see our life through. If our primary lens is fear or doubt or unbelief, we will never experience our life in Christ with joy because we see our future and it has holes in it. Because we see our future and we're unsure. Because we see our future and it's full of doubt. It's full of unknowns. But if God's faithfulness is the primary lens, if we consider God's faithfulness and we say we're going to put him first in our thinking, his faithfulness, then everything else is seen through that. And your life produces joy because he is faithful and he will do what he said. I may not know when, but it doesn't matter because he's big and I'm small. He's strong and I'm weak. He's rich and I'm poor. He has everything that I have need of, and he will take care of me, and he will take care of you. God is faithful. You see, we read that scripture so many times, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, when you face trials and tribulations of many kinds. And we say, well, if I'm going to consider it joy, then I can't have doubt, and I can't have fear, and I can't have tribulation. No, that's not true at all. Courage isn't even possible without fear being present. So it's not that I get rid of fear. I just put it in its right place. I put the action of what I should do, that's courage, in front of the fear, and guess what? I'm courageous. And you can't really have faith until there's the opportunity to doubt. And so doubt is present, but I choose to believe God instead of doubt, and that makes me a man or a woman of faith. Are you hearing me? I may have unbelief in my life. I may have it there. You know, because there's a part of you that says, well, logically it doesn't make sense. Yeah, that's why we need faith. But I choose to believe anyway, and I put that first. I choose to believe, even though there's unbelief. Jesus said to Jairus, when he said his daughter was dead, he said, hey, hold on now. I can feel it too. I can feel that unbelief. You just choose to believe. Believe first, and she's going to live. It's the power of where you place this thing. It's the power of position. See, our primary lens should be the lens of God's faithfulness. Now, what's your primary lens? What's the primary lens of your life that you look through?
Life sucks. It's going to be hard today. It's going to be hard tomorrow.
I was raised in a family like that. I choose to see things differently. God has good things. Most popular scripture that we put online is, I know the plans I have for you. They're plans full of hope and a future. They're plans that don't include harming you. They're to prosper you. Why is that the most popular scripture that we put online? Because people want to believe that God is good, and God is good. And God does want good things for you. But a lot of times we don't stand the test or the time because we get weak and we don't have the energy or the strength to hold on, and we let go right before the promise manifests. Let's look at this scripture again. I'm going to read the whole scripture to you in James, and then we're going to break it down. I'm going to show you some lenses. Consider it pure joy, guys, when you face trials and tribulations of many kinds, because they're coming. Because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Ooh, that's so exciting. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Now, if you lack wisdom, ask God, who gives generously to without finding fault. And that will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the seas blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Why? Because they're double-minded and unstable in all they do. Quick nugget. When you're going through a trial and a tribulation and you don't know what to do, that's a good place to be. Because you have the opportunity to grow. But you can't grow yourself. So ask God what you need to do. And He's going to give you the answer. And that answer becomes your anchor that holds you against the winds. Are you hearing me? You're in the middle of a trial and tribulation. Let's go context here. And He says, if you don't know what to do, ask God. And He's going to show you what to do. And that becomes the anchor against all of the waves, the doubts and the unbeliefs. They're coming. The doubts are coming. The unbelief is coming. Come on. Even the offense may come. The hurt may come. But if you've got God's word on this situation, that He spoke to you in your heart, not out of your head, that it came to you in your inner man, not your intellect. You found it out of the word of God, not just out of WhatsApp somewhere. You've got God's word on this thing, and you lock into that, and you return it to Him in prayer, and that becomes the anchor. And I'm standing on that. Come on, wave. You come. I have positioned your word and your faithfulness first in my life, and I am seeing everything through that lens. Now, I'm going to go through the scripture just briefly, three times, and I'm going to show you. We could all be sitting here today looking at me, and you could all be seeing something different. I could say something, and you would all hear something different. Because we filter everything through perception. And unfortunately, most of our perception is built on the pain of the past and the problems that we've had with people in the past, and we look toward our future through that. And that's why we do this. That's why we come together. So people who are far from God can know Him. If once they begin to know Him, then they can find freedom from those problems and those people and those things that were done to them in the past, so that they could begin to discover why they're truly here. And we're going to help them make an impact in the lives of other people. If you have a lens, let's call it victim's mentality. That's those whose primary lens is not God is faithful, but their primary lens is the lens of suffering. Let me tell you, I'm going to show you. Do you have that in yellow? Can you put that up there? I'm going to just read the words that I've highlighted here. This is the same exact scripture. And then we're going to read this. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters. But here are the words that I will focus on. Face trials. Another test. It's work. I lack. I must, or I don't qualify. I must not doubt. I'm blown and tossed. I should not, how dare I even think? I shouldn't expect to receive anything because I'm double-minded and unstable in all I do. Now, if you have a victim's mentality, that's the way you'll read that scripture. Because your lens is the lens of suffering. Now, let's say you've disciplined yourself and you've gotten into the Word and you've become a mature Christian. But now you don't have a lens of a victim's mentality. You got a lens of a works mentality. In other words, the primary lens that I look through is self-help. And we say things like, if it's going to be, it's up to me. All by myself. I'm going to have to pull myself up by my own bootstraps. A man that's worth any salt in life is going to stand on his own and make his own way. And that's the very first thing about Christianity. When we surrender, we say, hey, I've tried it. I can't do it. I really have. I've tried it. I've gone to all the lectures. I can't do it. I need help, God. I need you. My life surrendered to you is going to be better than my life with all this discipline because it isn't putting it together like I expected it to. But if I have a works mentality and I read this scripture, here are the words that I'm going to focus on. Face trials. That's good. Because then I can make my faith stronger and I can produce perseverance so that I can work. And when I work hard enough, I'm going to become mature and complete. And I'm going to ask God, but I can't just willy-nilly it. I've got to ask him and believe with all of my heart. And I cannot, will not doubt. And if I have a works mentality, I'm going to tell myself, I can't work hard enough. I shouldn't expect to receive anything from God. Now, there's another lens, and that's the lens of a victor's mentality. And before I go through that lens with you, I want to give you this opportunity to see there are two promises in your life. One promise is given to you by somebody that you've known all your life. You know they have the means, the will, and the integrity to do what they say. And they say, I am going to give you $100,000. And they have more than $100,000, and you've known that they're generous like that, and they've told you things before, and they've done it. Okay? In other words, you consider them faithful. But then there's a new person in your life who seems like they have a lot, but for all you know, it's all run up on credit cards. They seem like they're wealthy. And they say they're going to give you $100,000 for your ministry, for your church, for your vision, whatever it is, help you get out of debt. But you don't know them. You've heard a few rumors about them not doing what they say. You don't even know if they actually have that kind of green laying around. Now, how are you going to view the promise from the person you deem faithful versus the person that you don't know? What I fear is, as Christians, we don't know God in the way where we perceive him as faithful. So we look at him through the lenses of work. We look at him through the lenses of suffering. Instead of the generous, loving, giving Father that he actually is. So now, if I have a victor's mentality, that's those whose primary lens in life is that God is faithful. The same scripture again, okay? Here's what the words I'm going to see. Consider it joy. It's testing of my faith. It's testing whether or not I can stay in joy. Listen, I'm going to let it finish its work because it's not my work. It's the one doing the testing. I'm going to let it finish its work. And then when I do, I'll be mature. I'll be complete. I won't be lacking anything. And then when I ask God, it will be given to me because I believe. Do you see the difference? It's the same scripture. And it's packed full of promises. But we get all waylaid and hung up because it says trials and tribulation of many kinds. Patience and perseverance. And that really takes us back to the level that we think that our faith must be spontaneous and instantaneous, otherwise it's not faith. And that is not the way God works. He took hundreds of years to bring the law into place. He took hundreds of years for the prophets to speak. He took thousands of years for Jesus to come. He's giving the world thousands of years to come to Christ. He is patient. And he is loving, and he is a doer of his word. So let's go down to James chapter 1, verse 12. Are you with me? Consider it pure joy when you face stuff. Don't disconnect because you got stuff. If you don't have anything going on in your life that's not enjoyable, you're probably not doing anything. You're probably not moving in any direction. Because anytime you move, anytime you press in, anytime you attempt to make a difference in the lives of other people, anytime you try to better your family, anytime you try to better your neighborhood, you're going to go through stuff. And I got to be real honest with you. You can even back up and not try to do all those things, and you're still going to have stuff. So you're going to go through stuff and I'm going to go through stuff. That doesn't mean that I've sinned. That doesn't mean that I've erred. That doesn't mean I'm a weak Christian. It means I'm a Christian. The difference between me and the world, the difference between you and the world is you have Christ in you and you have the promises of God. And there's a scripture that says all of the promises of God. Does anybody know? All of the promises of God. Can anybody help me out? All of the promises of God are yes and amen in Christ. You know what that means? Yes, not no. And amen means let it be so. All of the promises. And if I don't know the promises, I can ask God and he's going to show me what it is. And I'm going to set this sucker down into my heart. And I'm going to put it in front of everything else. And I'm going to believe it, return it to God. And I'm going to anchor down. And I'm going to let the waves come. I'm going to let the storms come. I'm going to let the wind come. I'm going to let the lightning come. Why? Why am I going to let it come? Because I can't stop them. Faith does not stop the storm. Faith allows you to go through the storm with some semblance of joy. Faith allows you to go through with some sense of peace because he is with you and he will never leave you and he will never forsake you. He's the one that's in the boat and he's the only one who could calm the seas. And when he calms the seas, suddenly you're at your destination. Are you hearing me? Just because you have pain in your body, just because it's been a rough week, just because there are people that are throwing down on you and talking bad about you, just because these things are going on, doesn't mean that you've made a mistake. It means that you're on this earth and you're a Christian and you are going to receive trials and tribulations. But are you going to be a wet towel on the smoldering coals of somebody's life? Or are you going to be that breeze, that fresh air, and that breeze that blows across those coals and begins to fan a fire into their hearts and into their lives so they could live and burn bright? It's a matter of position. What's my first lens? My first lens has got to be God's faithfulness. This is so important to God. That every time there was a major miracle in the Old Testament, he would say, here's what I want you to do. I want you to stop everything. And I want you to build this structure or stack these stones or chop down this tree or build this well. And then I want you to throw a party over it. And I want you to throw that party every year so you remember what I did. Why? So that faithfulness will carry you through the desert. So that faithfulness of, that you remember will carry you through the stone. So that remembrance of that faithfulness that I've been in your life in this situation. When I got you through the Red Sea, when I took you through the Jordan, and you remember those things, then when sickness and disease attacks your family, you can go through it with joy. When you go through the financial crisis, you can go through it with joy. When your family is beginning to fall apart, you can go through it with joy because, listen, I'm the one who promised, and this is what I've done for you in your past. And I'm going to do it again. The lens of faithfulness and the power of position unlocks the miracle. James chapter 1 verse 12 says, blessed. Remember Jesus got the little children and he said, because they're coming to me this way, let me lay my hands on them. Let me bless them. This is the same train of thought. He says, consider it pure joy when you face trials and tribulations. If you don't know what to do, ask me. I'm going to show you. And that'll become your anchor. And then he says, you will receive the thing that you've asked for. He says, blessed is the one who perseveres under these trials. Because having stood the test, you will receive the crown that the Lord has promised to those who love him. If you're going to receive the promises as a little child, it will produce joy. Not when you get the thing. It's when you get the promise. Not necessarily when he said it, when you receive the promise. Get it? When you receive the promise and you're looking at your life through the lens of his faithfulness, that's your primary lens, it produces joy. I can't make myself be happy. I've been trying to smile for the last 10 years. It's kind of difficult for me. I'm getting better at it, but I can't make myself be happy. But when I focus on his and look through his faithfulness, that produces joy. Now, joy is the fuel that feeds patience. It gives the working material we need for perseverance. Did you hear me? We give up because we lose our joy. And we lose our joy because we quit focusing. Or looking through that lens of God's faithfulness. God is faithful. He has gotten me through so many things. Oh my goodness, 11 years ago, you could see the basement from here all the way up. There was so much rot and filth in this place, and we didn't have a penny. Or maybe negative a penny or two. Well, yeah, I thought it would be done in 2 years, but it's been 11. A lot of times, I got to tell you, I didn't go through it with joy. When Neesy and I first got married, we had this thing that was, we laugh about it now, but we would have a huge need. Maybe it was as small as a $10,000 need for an event we were doing overseas or $100,000 for a crusade. And we believe God for it, you know. And we'd get together and we'd have one gal that come over and we would do a prayer of agreement. In Jesus' name, we're claiming this, we're believing this, and we'd let it go. And a lot of times we'd celebrate and we'd laugh, you know. And then the trial and the tribulation. Come on, are you hearing me? Now you understand that those were things that God led us to do. It's not something we just created. Because faith begins where the will of God is known. And when you don't know, you ask Him. And that's what we were praying on. And then finally it would come through, whether it was, you know, a car being paid off, or maybe it was, you know, $100,000 for this particular crusade came through, or maybe it was this need that we had, whatever it was, it would come through. And she would get all excited. She'd do what I call her Charlie Brown dance. Her nose goes up and she goes like this. Woo! And I would look at her like, "You're just silly." And she'd get mad at me because I wouldn't celebrate. Because I wasn't joyful. I said, "Yeah, I'm happy. I'm really happy. I'm glad. I've just been waiting because I was happy when we prayed. 10 months ago, I was happy when we prayed. I received it then. I mean, and we didn't get in sync until just a couple years ago about that. Do you understand? I was happy when Grandpa said he was going to give me that cane pole. I wasn't happier when I got it because I'd already gotten it." So Jesus said in Mark chapter 11, I'm just going to read this real quick. He said, "Have faith in God. Truly I tell you, if you say to this mountain, go throw yourself in the sea and don't doubt, it'll be done for you. You don't have to do it." He said, "But you must not doubt and believe in your heart that what you say will happen, it'll be done for them. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you've received it and it will be yours." When Grandpa tells you it's yours, receive it. When God tells you He's going to do this for you in your life, receive it. "But I don't have it yet." You might not get it then. Faithful. So we choose to put God's faithfulness first. When I believe, I produce receiving joy. When I believe what God told me, when I believe what God shows me, when I believe what God communicates to me, when I ask Him now and He shows me, when I believe it, that's mine. I produce receiving joy. I'm not trying to put it on. Are you getting it? I'm not trying to put it on. I got it. It's mine. Now I got to pay for a new iPad. Praise the Lord. It's mine. I got it. Well, when's it coming? I don't know. What happens if between here and there? I don't know, but I know I've got it. When I produce receiving joy, I will have what God has promised. Sorry, table. Be healed, table. I produce joy when I choose the power of position. The primary lens we should view our whole Christian life through should be God's faithfulness. Now, do you understand it's a lens? It can get smudged. You might need to clean it off every now and then. That's okay. You might even lose your lens for a while. Get it back. God can get you another one. I choose, say this with me, I choose God's faithfulness. Say, I choose God's promise. Say, I choose God's word. Say, I choose to receive my miracle. And the greatest choice you could ever make is to surrender your life to Jesus Christ. So many people have been in church all their lives and they've never truly surrendered. Oh man, there's no place like it. Because when I give Him everything that I have, He gives me everything that He has. When I don't hold anything back, He doesn't hold anything back. I give Him all that I have and He gives me all that He is. Surrender. Would you bow your head with me this morning? If you're in this place this morning and you're living a life that's so far from God, you know you need to come closer. Then I do want to pray with you. I'm not going to ask you to come forward. If you choose this morning to surrender to the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm telling you, here's what's going to happen. He's going to forgive you of your sin. He's going to make your spirit brand new. Everything on the inside will be new. And that way he could fill you with his life. He can fill you with his spirit. He can fill you with his strength. You'll never be alone again. I didn't say it'll be easy, but it'll be better. And he'll carry you through all the way to heaven. But to do that, you've got to give him all that you are. He's not asking just for your heart. He's asking for all of you. If you want to do that this morning, whether you join us online or you're here this morning, it doesn't matter if anybody can see, but he can see. God sees. If that's you, I just want you to lift your hand up, even right there online. Lift your hand up. We're all going to pray this prayer together with them. Are you ready? We'll just make this good confession. Dear Heavenly Father, I believe in your Son, Jesus. I believe you raised him from the dead. Today, I make Jesus the Lord of my life. Today, I choose to surrender. Fill me with your Spirit. Empower me with your strength. Love me with all that you are. In Jesus' name.